A balloon can't rise if there are weights holding it down. So the more that we create this coherence, the connection between the heart and the mind, we're taught that the mind is the most powerful part of the body, right? That's actually the heart, because the heart has 40,000 neurons. It feels, it senses, it's intelligent. It's an intelligent system. And so what we're doing is when we're connecting, when we're closing our eyes, when we're meditating, we're creating this flow. Think about coherence like a radio. If you're not tuned in, it's like, shh, and that's the stress, right? When you start to tune in, there's that coherence that's created, and then you start to hear the voice of the person that's speaking on the radio. That's your connection. So when we close our eyes, when we slow things down, we are getting out that noise and bringing ourselves back to ourselves. So one of my goals, you know, in my programs where I help with entrepreneurs is getting people to be consistent with their meditation, getting people to their first hour, because I know what shift that had for me. Because then when you're running your business from intuition, and you're accessing your zone of genius, this is where you start to break through your financial blocks. This is where you start to make jumps and leaps and bounds, because you're letting go of resistance. With things like meditation, we can't see it as just a thing that we use to reduce our stress if we're stressed. We use meditation as a thing to access intuition so that we can let go of certain things that then can allow us to move forward. Every time you develop an area of emotional and energetic intelligence, you increase your self-value and also your wealth. Because you plug yourself into this awesome place where you're being guided. And that's the challenge we're having. We're trying to be connected, but everything, every single day from the moment that we wake up is working against us. That's the problem. So we're always being taken out of tune. We're always fuzzy.
Welcome to the Awakening Entrepreneur Podcast. This show is for entrepreneurs. They have chosen to define their life beyond the material. They have followed their soul on a hero's journey towards the mystery of the spiritual. I'm your host, Garrett Ng. Each episode will be learning from awakened entrepreneurs and spiritual thought leaders. They have broken through the mold of being ordinary to extraordinary, challenging our paradigm. Shining lights to the dark, giving hope when there is doubt. The moment of truth is upon us. It is time to transcend our world from fear to love. Are you ready? Let's go.
Welcome to this week, Awakening Entrepreneur. This week we've got an amazing guest. His name is Simon Lavelle. I would say he's one of the lighthouses that's been shining light at me, even though this is the first time we've actually communicated in terms of being on the call. Simon is part of the Tony Robbins Platinum Partnership group that I'm a big part of. And he shared a book, it's called A Black Ball, and it's basically described his journey as an entrepreneur, his ego identity of who he is, and then something changed. Like, he's invested all this money, all this time, over $250,000 in personal development, creating this archetype of who we know who we are. And then one day, suddenly something came crashing down and shook him up on his life views and life perspective. And he called it the spiritual awakening. I remember for me, like for 41 years of my life, despite how much I thought that I've learned, I never really heard of the term spiritual awakening or awakening of any sort. And or maybe I've heard it, but I just never really took a hold of me inside my head that I paid attention to. And so when I started experiencing a difficult period, really dark period, even though the external seems good, Simon's book really gave me a lot of clarity, and also the knowing that I'm not the only one going through this phenomena. And these days, what also excites me, Simon has also integrated his spiritual journey, his awakening journey, and a lot of the learnings along the way back into business and coaching other entrepreneurs on how to build a more conscious business, I guess a more conscious world. So welcome, Simon.
Yeah, it's great to be here with you. Yeah, I think this is an important conversation for everyone. It's going through life, and let's be honest with you, because this, what you're talking about, is just our own natural evolution. So yeah.
So for those of you that haven't read the book, The Black Ball, I recommend you get it, whether it's from Amazon, wherever you can get it, you can look it up on Google, and I'll put some links on this site. But Simon, can you share some of your stories in that book on how you got here today?
Yeah, so I mean, it all starts really when I was, 6 years old, honestly. And the series of events that impacted me, which were a trauma. you know? And so as I was growing up, I had this series of events that happened and bullying and all of these things that really impacted me as a small boy, right? As the mini version of Simon Lovell. And as I grew up, I started to, you know, really isolate myself. And for a lot of entrepreneurs, the drive that we have can be from like wanting to prove people wrong, right? And wanting to be successful because it's like, we want to fight back at the bullies or we want to fight back at society for doing us bad. And so that was me. I always dreamed of being a millionaire and making $1 million. And, you know, I created a vision board in 2013, which had the Ferrari on it and the big house and the mansion and, you know, all the money in the bank. And, you know, I think for any entrepreneur, you know, when you get focused, you can actually do a lot. You can achieve a lot. You can be a lot. And so that's what I did as I focused and I got everything that I wanted on that vision board, as well as some also, not just material things, but some also really cool things, you know, apart from that, like my mum and my sister reconnecting and just some really awesome things. But most of it was material. And so what happened was, is that the more I started to acquire, the more I started to add things to my life, which were extrinsic. We got intrinsic and extrinsic motivators, right? And drivers. So the more I acquired these extrinsic things, these items, right? The more I started to feel off. And I think that this is really common in the entrepreneurial space, which is like just a sense that something's up, you know, a sense that I don't know what it is. I can't put my finger on it. But something doesn't feel right here. And that's what I was feeling. And when I reached, I call it the height of my ego. When I was in the mansion, when I had the Ferrari outside and I got to this place and I started to ask this question, which was, where am I leading people to? I'm a leader. I'm leading all of these clients. I've got all of these followers, the people that look up to me. And I was like, where am I leading people to? And that concerned me. That was a concerning statement that I continued to loop around in my head. And that was when I went on a deeper journey. And, you know, we're in the same space. So, you know, when you're part of, you know, Tony Robbins, when you're part of personal development, you're investing a lot in yourself, not just financially, but you're also investing time, effort, and energy in that. And the Black Ball came about because I was invited to a series of, they're called connection games. And in this connection games, we're basically asked to go deeper in conversation. So one of the things you asked me before I came on the podcast, is anything off topic? And I was like, obviously no, because I'm an open book, right? And the deeper we go, the more that we can transform. And so I'd gone to these events, Encinitas, California, and I was invited to this house. And in this home, we started to have these connection games. And it would go something like this. You would sit opposite someone and you would say, hey, I really appreciate your hair, you know, and your smile. And they would say, in hearing that, this is what I feel. And then you would go deeper and deeper and deeper and you would go beyond surface level. We've all been to the networking events where you're like, hey, how are you? What do you do? And it's very surface level, right? Well, these connection games were going deeper, like really getting to know each other. And then there was this game called Anybody Else. And in this game, you get into a circle and you step into the circle and you say something like, I sabotage relationships. And because of that, I feel lonely. Anybody else? And anybody else that feels the same way steps into the circle. And a guy stepped into the circle and he said something, but I couldn't step in. And I noticed the resistance. I was frozen. And in that moment, I was very frustrated because I not only was able, had an opportunity for me to step in and say something which could help me, but also I was really frustrated because I couldn't step in for him because he needed someone else to step in for him. So that played with me throughout the night. So then as we went into this other game called Hot Seat. And in this game, Hot Seat, you would basically ask mild, medium, or spicy questions and go really deep. And on the way over to the game and the sofa, there was a black ball on the floor. It was a juggling ball. And I picked it up. And whenever we're thinking about something, we do something. So whether we pick our fingers or whether we like, if you got hair, I don't have hair, right? But if you might twirl your hair, whatever the thing is. Well, for me, I had this outlet, which was this black ball. So I was playing with this ball. I was juggling it up and down. And I went in to sit into the hot seat. And my roommate at the time, Jessica, said to me, so what was it you didn't step in for? And in that moment, I spoke up about the thing that I was most ashamed of and most embarrassed about. I mean, you could call it embarrassment, you can call it shame, you can call it whatever you want. It was a multitude of things, right? It was just heaviness. And this ball launched itself out of my hands and landed on the floor. And it was the black ball symbolized the letting go of the shame, the letting go of the heaviness, talking about the thing that I had not wanted to tell anyone. Right. And I talk about this, which is if we have our truest self, which is who we are core, right? There's a great book called The Five Regrets of the Dying. And one of those regrets is that I wish I lived my life true to myself. Well, if we have our core, which is us in the middle, like the middle of a dartboard, the moment I released that shame, the moment I spoke up about that thing that I didn't want to tell anybody, I came home closer towards myself. And it was through that event, letting go of the house, saying, hey, I don't want to have the Ferrari anymore, letting go of all of the egoic things that I didn't really need. And actually, I started to focus on what does Simon want? What does my heart want versus what do I need? Because I think that what we do is we get what we need, not what we get what we want, not what we need, what the ego wants. The moment I started to strip back and let go, that's when I had my awakening. That's when I came home to myself and I really went through this massive energetic shift. And it's like peeling back the layers. I mean, we're always continuously doing that, right? Peeling back the layers. So that was the journey. That was the moment of awakening. But we're always going through levels of awakening. It's not like we get to the top of the mountain one day and we have this spiritual shift and energetic shift. It's like, hi, I reached the mountain. Now my life is done. I mean, it doesn't work like that. I mean, it's just a layer, you know, a layer that we go through, layers of self-awareness. So yeah.
Wow, that's extremely profound, especially this part of me I recognize, and I'm sure for a lot of people that's listening to this, inside there's certain fear that we have. What if people find out? What if, yes, this, what is this? It's just a fear of sharing something, or just fear or some other traumas that's holding us back. But when we confront our fear, like my son yesterday, he had the fear of going on a certain jump with the bike. And I was just talking to him that it's just a story, like an illusion that's been created. It's not factual. You haven't experienced it yet, but inside there's certain fear that's been generated that if I do this, this will happen. In my case, in a lot of people's case, it's like if we share this, if people find out, then it will be X. The paradox is that the X, what we imagine it to be, and usually is compared to the reality when you do share it or when you do experience that thing, is two different things. And usually from my recollection, is it comes with a profound sense of freedom. It's like what you said, like, what if I don't have the Ferrari? What if I don't have the big house? It may seem like, oh man, that will feel bankruptcy, unsuccessful, I'm not going to get as many friends and yada, yada, yada. But without, if you're hanging on to it without letting go that you have so beautifully described, you don't get that sense of freedom from hanging on to all this stuff.
All of it comes down to is that there's a part of us within us that doesn't want to speak up. And because that was shut down when we were young. Because if we were planted on this earth right now and it's like, hey, go and talk about the thing that you did, we wouldn't have any negative associations to it. It's like if you've got an adult, you know, the thing with your son, right? It's like if you have an adult on a plane and a child on a plane, and the plane starts rocking, well, the adult's mental picture is, this thing's going down, this thing's going to crash because he's seen TV, he's seen movies. The plane is rocking, the child's going, this is fun, this is fun. And so the difference between the adult and the child is that the references, the mental references that the adult is pulling versus the child, that's the difference. And so if there's typically that fear, that frozenness, that point of us not wanting to do it is because either we've seen things, experienced things, or we've had an event in the past which has created this energetic interruption, and that cycle was not complete in the past. It's called the arousal cycle, right? When an event, when something happens in the past and it doesn't get energetically complete, what happens is then mentally we need it to be complete, which is why we continue being in fight or flight. And so that's, I was in so much fight or flight for most of my life because I'd not completed the cycle of the bullying. I hadn't spoken up. And the thing about the quantum field and about energetics is that you can complete those cycles. You can actually complete that healing now from events that have happened 30 years ago. I was working with a guy around his anger, right? And it's like within a couple of sessions, like 30 years of anger gone because I completed the cycle that he did not complete because of something that he was unaware of in the past. Wow. And that's transformational. So what happens is, so in the animal kingdom, you have, like, for example, I have a dog, right, Buddha. So when he gets, like, if another dog attacks him, he will go into this freeze and he will freeze up, right? Same as humans. But what a dog does is it shakes off the energy and it completes its cycle. But when you're young, right, you don't have that skill set within you. So let's just imagine you get bullied, or imagine that you, something happens like a car crash or whatever, and something happens and interrupts the energy. If we don't complete that cycle, if we don't essentially shake it off and complete it mentally, it gets stuck in time. And then our sequence of events that happen after that, for example, we'll get into a codependent relationship or we'll self-sabotage something. We're not aware of it, but it's because there's a trapped energy. So if we get frozen doing anything, Oftentimes that's why, because the cycle has not been complete. So a lot of the work that I do is actually about completing those cycles. So the black ball is a part of that process. By speaking up, for some people, they're completing a cycle that they didn't complete in the past.
So I really love it that you talk about, I think like in Buddhism term, it talks about samskara, and you frame that, you put it in such a modern way that we can all easily understand, that closing off the energy. So for those of the people that's listening or watching this podcast, if they have awareness over some of the childhood traumas or traumas of the past that is a recurring thing that they keep on experiencing, how would you suggest that they attempt to close off that loop or their energy?
It can be challenging to do it on your own, which is why you want someone to guide you through that. It is possible to do it on your own though, but there's so many, when someone's, even if someone's aware of the pattern, or sorry, they're aware of the event that's happened, in order to complete that cycle, you need to go through a series of steps. Like in my process, like there's around 10 steps to complete that process because I hit it from multiple angles. But it could be, right? Some cases are more serious than others, but in one case, it could be a conversation with someone that completes a cycle, right? Like think about it, right? If you've got this resentment energy with someone and it's just like, there's that still that thing going on, right? You can have a clarifying conversation and then suddenly the energy gets released because now that energy is not trapped in time.
Yeah.
Right? This is what happens when people don't speak for years. My mom and my sister, they didn't speak for like 7 years. Why? Because an event happened, the energy, something happened, it got trapped in time, and that sequence was not complete for 7 years. But eventually, when they came around to having a conversation again, that cycle got complete. And that's what people want to be aware of. Is that their anxiety, their self-sabotage, their depression, the heaviness that they feel, the sadness that they feel, the addictions that they may have, right? The soothing that we do can all be, I wouldn't want to say, it can all come to a place of flow and ease where you come to a place of like inner calm and inner peace. And we either are aware of what's causing us the pain and we don't want to face it and deal with it, or we're completely unaware of it. So when I say to people, if you're aware of something and you're not dealing with it, that's your choice. Like I'll be very direct and say, you're choosing to not deal with this. You're choosing to continue to avoid it. But if we've got something going on, we're not aware of it, that's the time to go and get help. That's the time to go and say, hey, I'm feeling something. Now it's been going on for like a few months or 6 months or whatever it is. I don't know what it is. I'm not aware of what this is, but I know I want to change. I know I want to feel different. That's where you need to go and seek help and seek advice of someone who can ask you questions that are going to be challenging, that can actually start to create safety. And this is actually key. This is critical, because if someone doesn't feel safe, the first stage of healing for someone is safety, because we didn't feel safe at the time. So it's very important that you're able to connect with the person that you're working with. And you won't be able to do that if you don't feel safe with them. So creating the environment of safety is critical when it comes to healing.
Wow. So it's almost like if you're seeing something that, let's just say, you can see a Rubik's Cube, but you can only see two sides from your angle. You can say, okay, which color you choose is up to you. However, there are times that you've got blind spots. You can't see what other sides, what other colors are on the Rubik's Cube or on the cube. That's when you can bring in other people that have other perspective. Be it just someone that just, it could be a stranger, the universe somehow like connected you with, or someone with a higher consciousness that they can see from perspective that you very limited. You can only see from the 2D. They can see from 3D, 4D, 5D, or whatever the various angles. And they can give you a higher perspective that can also, by spending time there or getting those wisdom, can lift you up as well, can help you close off some of those loops. I really love a lot of the concept you've shared. So being an entrepreneur for a big part of your life, what was the first time that when you come across some of the challenges that you've came across that you described in your book, that you start to differentiate between personal development and spiritual awakening? Because I just need to learn more skills. I need to learn more things. And even like meditation is a skill and awareness is a skill. But like, because for me, I know a distinctive difference, but I've never tried to categorize that, hey, how, what is the difference? Obviously, like, well, I feel that you have the answer. How do you, when do you know, and how do you know the difference?
That's a very good question, which I've not been asked before, and I love it. So my journey through personal development started with an anxiety attack that I had in the UK. And, you know, I started to look at videos of how to, like, overcome my anxiety, right? And I came across a Tony Robbins video. And that's when I started to listen to audios and, like, hear someone's voice telling me certain things. And then I suddenly get to this place where you're like, oh, I can actually change the way I think. Like, that's a big moment. That's a huge moment. Anyone that's been in personal development knows that moment. It's the moment that you don't know how to deal with something. And then it's the moment you realize that, my God, someone's telling me that I can actually change the way I think and then change my life. Awesome. I'm in. I'm bought in. And the moment you actually change one thing and you're like, oh my God, I just changed this belief or something, like, you're sold. You're sold to this concept of personal development. So then what happens is when you start that journey, then you start to still get stressed out, right? You still, things happen because of life. And then what happens is you hear about this thing called meditation. And then you're like, oh, this is some weird thing that is very woo-woo. And you just sit under a tree and it looks really stupid. And that's, and then you go through that cycle. And that's the start. But then you're like, well, you know, I'm really feeling not too great today. And I'm really stressed out. So I'm going to give this thing a go. I'm not going to tell any of my mates about it, right? Because they might think I'm a bit weird. So then you download, like, the calm.com app or the headspace.com app. And then you're like, you got your thing in your ears and you're closing your eyes. And then you're like, this is kind of weird. Like, how do I do this? This can't be working right. I'm not meditating right. So then you go through this stage of like 5 to 10 minutes of meditation. And then you're like, oh my God. And then you start to feel a bit better about yourself. So then you're sold into like the meditation, but you're still, this is, I would like, I'm just going through my journey. So I don't know if anyone else relates to this, but this is my journey. Right. So then you're still in personal development. To me, I wouldn't have classed myself as like spiritual. Like, I went to Sunday school, I went to like a church when I was young, but then I got involved in like drugs and stuff and I lost my path and connection to God, right? So meditation was the gateway to back to myself, which is then spiritual, right? What we call spiritual. But even then, still meditation, I wouldn't have labeled myself as spiritual. The turning point was actually for me in India. Did you go to that trip? Did you do the India trip? So that's when you go into immersion, right? That's when you go deeper. And the difference between 5 or 10 minutes of meditation with an app, which is bringing you back to a place if you get stressed out, versus actually feeling energy and a connection with something and being able to heal something and feel the difference between like a voice that's speaking to you and then your ego, that's when you start to understand that there's a power and a force which is outside of you. I think that that's the moment. That's the moment where you're like that spirit, soul, personality, right? So we got our personality, we got our soul, and then we got spirit. So it's a click, it's a moment, right? And then you open the door and pass through. And whether you want to call it God or spirit or source or whatever, right? It's the connection. It's plugging yourself in. It's like, I say it's like a Tesla, right? You're plugging yourself in to source and connection. And to me, that was a turning point. The turning point for me was India.
Yeah, wow. Because I find that when you're in the personal development world, you depend on some external teachers or gurus. And even it's all about me, my ego, but I'm still, I'm using these tools, these external tools. And how do I acquire more tools, better tools, so I can do the transformation and be even more successful? When you're going through the spiritual awakening or through this path, it's more about internal. I've got all the tools in here. How do I remove a lot of the bullshit layers, the stories, the belief system that's blocking me to seeing the answers that I've always had?
We do that by letting go of resistance. I have this saying, a balloon can't rise if there are weights holding it down. So the more that we create this, what's called coherence, the connection between the heart and the mind, because we're taught that the mind is the most, you know, powerful part of the body, right? That's actually the heart, because the heart has 40,000 neurons. It feels, it senses, it's intelligent. It's an intelligent system. And so what all we're doing is when we're connecting, when we're closing our eyes, when we're meditating, we're creating this flow, because maybe it's like a radio. Think about coherence like a radio. Like, if you're not tuned in, it's like, and that's the stress, right? When you start to tune in, there's that coherence that's created, and then you start to hear the voice of the person that's speaking on the radio, right? That's your connection. So when we close our eyes, when we slow things down, we are getting out that noise and bringing ourselves back to ourselves. And it's from that place, you know, some of my biggest, best business ideas and opportunities have been created from, you know, 40-minute, 50-minute, 90-minute meditations. So one of my goals, you know, in my programs, what I have with entrepreneurs is getting people to be consistent with their meditation, getting people to their first hour, because I know what shift that had for me, you know, because then when you're running your business from intuition, when you're accessing your zone of genius, this is where you start to break through your financial blocks. This is where you start to make jumps and leaps and bounds because you're letting go of resistance, right? With things like meditation, we can't see it as just a thing that we use to reduce our stress if we're stressed. We use meditation as a thing to access intuition so that we can let go of certain things that then can allow us to move forward. Like I can remember, I think it was like 70,000 a month to 100,000 a month in my business in 1 month, and it was a jump, but that jump came from letting go of a fear. And that once that fear was let go of, which was worrying about what people thought of me, then my business jumped and leaped and moved forward. So, but we don't associate to that because we see it as it's not tangible. It's not a tangible thing, right? Spirituality, like give me something tangible. But it's so important that we don't look at it like that. Because if we actually look at it, like if I learn the skills and I get the intel and information and the intelligence, the emotional intelligence, which is what I teach, emotional and energetic intelligence. Once we develop, every time you develop an area of emotional and energetic intelligence, you increase your value, your self-value, and also your wealth. So because you plug yourself into this awesome place where you're being guided, and it's not always perfect. It's not always like completely, you know, ideal. Why? We're living in the Western world. We've got social media. We got all these distractions. You know, it's a challenge. We're always working against something. And that's the problem. That's the challenge we're having. We're trying to be connected, but everything, every single day from the moment that we wake up is working against us. That's the problem. So we're always being taken out of tune. We're always fuzzy.
So Simon, like the awakening journey for me and for a lot of people I interview on the podcast, it wasn't a walk in the park. It wasn't like a very pleasant, easy journey to go on. It's some of the most difficult that they've encountered. Do you want to share like from your experience and also from a lot of entrepreneurs that you coach that may be going through some of these experiences? What is the journey typically like and how do we, what's the best way to transcend beyond it?
So I'll take it into two questions. What's the journey like?
Yeah, because like, I guess one of the things is like, since I've done a lot of personal development, but yet it seems like nobody gave me a heads up like this is quite possible, it will come. And so when it happened, it's like, what's wrong with me? Like, it felt very alone. It felt, yeah, like all the tools that I've acquired, personal development, none of that helped me. And I just, existential crisis, even though outside it looks great, but for maybe it's a conversation I had or incident I had, it's nothing too significant, but internally it was tearing me apart in that particular moment in time. And when I talk to other people on the podcast, like same, but different journey, like they've gone through. So what was it like for you? And since you've talked to a lot of different entrepreneurs, like, do you see a recurring theme that people go through in what people may describe as dark nights of the soul or whatever difficulties they may be going through?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because on one side of it, you've got the life of addiction, you've got the life of self-sabotage, and you've got that life. And at the time, it's actually fun. You think it's fun, right? It's a normal life. And then you go through this journey of awakening. And I would say like my phrase is like being the best version of me. Like I want to be the best version of Simon Lovell so that I can show up in relationships and to my clients in the best possible way without the really negative reactions and the just the things that I was really embarrassed about when I was going through that stage of my life. But at the same time, the awakening journey is also really painful because it's addressing your shadow, right? It's the willingness to address the parts of you that are dark, right? That most people don't want to talk about. And so what's happened is we've normalized certain things and we've shut away these deeper feelings. But we actually need to realize that these feelings that we're having are actually normal, you know? So we're not used to feeling these intense emotions and crying all the time sometimes to really, you know, you might go through like a month or two of just releasing because you've suppressed so much, right? That's, you were asked, some of my clients go through, well, for the first time, they're starting to express themselves, and suddenly opening the floodgates is a common theme, right? Because so much has been shoved down because maybe with your parents, it wasn't acceptable to show emotion. So when you're experiencing all of that, and then you've got all this stuff, you're like, what do I do with this? Like, I can't show this to anybody. And then that's where we can create that loneliness, you know, because what we feel is like, nobody understands me. Nobody gets me. And we still want to isolate. And even, especially during this time, it's so important to be proactive, reaching out to people to have these types of conversations with other people where I can go, yeah, me too, you know, because we suddenly start to realize that we're actually one and the same. And I talk about levels of performance. My program is called the Super High Performance Formula. And so I talk about these four different levels of performance. And there's when energy is being pulled away, which is low performance. There's performing, where you're actually getting by. Then you've got high performance and then super high performance. Now, high performance can be, is very dangerous. And here's why. Because high performance is seen as the be-all, end-all in the entrepreneurial world. If you're a high performer, right, then you're it. And I say to people, why is it then that high performers are killing themselves? And the reason is because they're not addressing and not being able to emotionally handle the shadow. So I talk about super high performance, which is when we're actually letting go of the things which are holding us back so that we can have success, which is about making money and being fulfilled. Now, getting to the place of fulfillment and happiness means on the other side of the river, which is all sparkles and, you know, it looks good, but actually when you get over there, you're still going to have some stuff to go through. There's a load of mud in the way. And that mud can be difficult conversations with people from your past. That mud can be dealing with the trauma and completing the event you had in the past. That mud can be, for a lot of entrepreneurs, letting go of a business and doesn't feel aligned to them now because they've evolved and now they've shifted their, like, who they want to work with, which is what happened to me. I let go of a multi-million dollar business because it didn't feel aligned to me. That mud can be a relationship that's toxic that now you've evolved and you're like, I now feel worthy to actually go out and be out on my own and not allow this toxicity in my life anymore. That mud can be so many different things. But what happens is that you come to a place where you're like, and I had this today actually with a client who just came onto a call and I was like, his energy was different. And he used to come on the call to, like, I could sense it was this underlying anger and unawareness and he didn't know what was going on. And he came onto the call today and he's like lighter. And I said, you've changed. And so what happens is we reach this point. And then we're like, I can't believe, and I'm sure you had this too, I can't believe that I feel like this and I felt like that. And in the place that I sit now with you on this podcast, and the place that you are sat on this podcast, in 3 months' time, in 6 months' time, in a year's time, in 2 years' time, we will also say, I can't believe I felt like that when I was on the podcast. That's the layers. So it does get easier. But if you're into this stuff, then what happens is you will still want to go into the well and do the deep work, which is always going to be hard. And the hardness is when someone is telling you something or suggesting something to you that you don't want to hear because you think you're right. And those are the blind spots. Those are the difficult conversations where you think that you've figured it all out, but and then suddenly you realize after difficult, challenging conversation from somebody you respect that you don't. Because all of my biggest changes and shifts have come from not the easy conversations with the people that have been guiding me, but the really tough ones. And that's why I say to people, if you want to work with someone like me, it's not going to be easy to hear because what I'm sharing and what I'm bringing to the surface is the reality of what you're not willing to face.
Yeah, I guess a lot of the spiritual teaching talks about the darkness or the suffering is a catalyst for awakening because it's actually trying to push the light out. And what you're doing is facilitating to, hey, these are the shadow stuff that you haven't dealt with properly. And you need to work on these because otherwise you're going to get on the same spiral and you're just going to get stuck where you're at.
If you're holding onto a black ball, which is, and most people have multiple ones, which is a shame, embarrassment, guilt. When you let go of that black ball, you walk out with a light ball. You walk out light. And this is the phrase that people say when they read the book, then they do the work, is they say, I feel lighter. That's the phrase, which is really interesting because once you let go of the black and the dark, you suddenly feel lighter. You are in the light. And then, and this is the thing I need to share with people about, especially the black ball work, which is very transformational, which is every time that you lie, every time that you do something which is out of alignment with yourself, every time that you ignore the little whisper, which is truth, you can also create another black ball. It's like gremlins. Never actually used that phrase, but it's like that, right? It's like gremlins. You can start to create more and more of them. And just because you've gone on a spiritual journey and just because you've invested in some Tony Robbins courses does not mean that you're not susceptible to go back into old patterns. And that's a big a common mistake I notice for a lot of people. Like, well, I did this course, I did this training in the past. Yes, you can have a identity shift, but if you're not consistent with your meditation, you're not consistent with, and you start to let people in your life and go back to old patterns, you can be brought down. That can still affect your business. All of that, you're still susceptible to that, right? We're not superhuman. We're all, and especially because of COVID, that's what's happened to a lot of people, right? People thought that they were strong. People thought they had it all together. And the truth is that people have crumbled with the trauma that is COVID.
So if someone's got stuff in their wardrobe, whether it's lying, cheating, stealing, something they're not proud of, what's your advice to them if they want to, I guess, pursue the path of feeling lighter?
Resolve it. Come to completion with it. Admit it. Stop shoving it down. It's like having debt. I've had a lot of debt in my past. It's like having debt and saying and ignoring it. It's not there. I'll deal with it. It's like the bill that comes. Just like, I'll just ignore the bill and then you get the red reminder. Well, the red reminder in your body is the anxiety, right? So if you've taken actions and you've not dealt with them, you know you need to have conversations or you know you need to apologize or you know you need to put things right. You're always being told that because it's always coming into your awareness. Because I call it a universal slap. That's what I call it. It's called a universal slap. It's when the universe is saying, hey, listen, I need you to deal with this, but you're ignoring me. So I'm going to slap you harder until you get it.
Then you love that feeling.
Yeah. And that slap is anxiety. It's the depression. It's the confusion, right? It's always there. Oprah calls it the whisper, you know, the little voice that's like, oh, that person comes into your awareness. And again, and again, and again. And it's like, we know what we got to do, but we just don't want to do it.
So what is life about for you now?
I just came off a retreat and doing some deep work. So that was very transformational for me. And now just going about focusing on my clients and how honestly simplifying. That's what I'm focusing on at the moment. What can I simplify versus add to? So I find that when I just add anything and add, it all gets too much. So how can I simplify? What can I sit down and journal about today that I can remove from my plate energetically? And I decided today that I just want to commit to getting more people up to their hour of meditation through my mentorship, through my programs. And I know, because I know the turning points that happen through that. And it's not just about relaxing. It's about people leading with power, authentic power. It's about being an unshakable leader.
Yeah.
That's the name of my podcast, Unshakable Leaders. I want to create leaders that feel in alignment and in flow, where they say to me, you know, you changed my life. And actually the theme of what really does that is reconnection with family, I've found. People reconnecting with their parents, having better conversations, like seeing something that they didn't see before in themselves, and now they're able to go and connect at a deeper level. That's what fuels me. Like, I love it when a client hits a new financial number and all that. It's cool to hear, like, I made the sale, blah, 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 blah. But it doesn't even get close to when someone messages me and says, my dad was dead to me and now we're having a relationship. That's it. That's the gold.
So in your own personal quest, you've let go of a lot of things or surrender to a lot of things and collapsing the ego. What would you say was the most challenging one for you to let go of?
For a long time, I knew that, like, the car and the house was like, there was something up, but I couldn't figure it out. And I was like, I was so attached to that material success because it was validation for me. You know, it was like I would get something from it when people saw me. But, and so getting to that point and having that level of resistance, and then really getting to the point of like, what does my heart want? What makes me happy? You know, that resistance was very, very big there. But then when I finally made the decision, I mean, everything happens in those moments of decision, right? Like the moment the decision was made and I called the real estate company and said, I'm going to move out. And I was like, I'm just like, you know, letting go of the car. Like I can't tell you when you do something like that. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with having a Ferrari or having a mansion at all. So if you listen to this and you know, you're like, what the hell is he talking about? It's not about that being wrong, but it was not right for me.
It no longer served you.
The underlying intent, well, I say it like this, right? When you've got a Ferrari, but you're driving it around, not because it's like you like the drive and you it's a hobby or whatever, but you're driving it around for significance. There's a big difference around that. In fact, the house, the mansion was great for events, but it was just too big for me. You know, like it's 1.5 acres. I now live in like a 2,000 square foot place, you know, because it's not, it's like what I need, not what I want. And so it's not that those things are wrong to have those. And maybe in the future I'll have them again. I don't know. Right. But for me, it was an important decision. So letting things go. But I can't tell you that doing that, the biggest shift for me was the moment I made that decision, I stopped comparing myself to people. Because what I was doing when I had those, I was always comparing myself to the guy that was doing X amount a month and the guy that had this and had the big hair. And I always had to like jump and be like getting the next thing and the next car up. And it was draining. Like it was so draining. And when you let go of those things and you're like, I don't care. You stop comparing yourself and you get your power back. It's liberation. That's what it is. And that was the hardest, but also the most, like, that's freedom. That was freedom to me.
Right. So what is your view of money? Because I guess from the angle of, again, like the whole self of entrepreneurs, money equals success and success equals happiness in a short summary. But I guess now they're looking at it, money is almost like it's a form of the saber-toothed tiger is no longer around. It's the modern day of the saber-toothed tiger in the sense that we'll never have enough. So it's the external threat is what if we don't have enough? And it keeps driving to, I need more, I need more. I can't just meditate. I need to make more money. Like, it's easy for you to say, Simon, but like you've got your other stuff looked after, but I don't have enough. I need more money.
So yeah, what's my view on money now? I went through a period of darkness when it came to that because my whole paradigm had shifted. You know, I'd let go of this company. I made money wrong. And when you make something wrong, you're going to go downhill. So now I see money as, you know, first of all, energy, a tool, but I'm not attached to it. And actually it flows a lot better now than it was. But also I went, you know, we all go through these dips and we all go through these different stages and everyone's different. But what I notice is that when I let go, when I surrender, things just start to appear and show up. And so I think honestly, like that is continuous work when you spent most of your life living in a world where you're taught certain things. And so part of my journey through awakening has been unlearning. Like marketing, for example, manipulation marketing or sales, where it's like hard closing and the language is just off now. And I don't sell the way I used to. I don't do that anymore because it doesn't feel right to me. I'm still growing my business. I'm still taking on clients. I'm still doing things, but I'm doing them differently. And so when it comes to money, you just do money differently.
Yeah.
Just like you do marketing differently,
yeah.
You know, and that's through evolution. And I think, you know, conscious business is very important.
Yeah.
Because if you are, you know, the truth is that I work with amazing clients now that are not a pain in the ass, right? They're really great to work with. And that's because I've upgraded myself in my language. I've upgraded myself in how I show up. I've upgraded me. If I were to use the old way of doing things, which was my old strategies, which I've now unlearned, I wouldn't be able to get these clients because it wouldn't resonate with them. And that's the thing we have to understand. A big lesson that people need to know about unconscious selling versus conscious selling, for example, is that when you have a target to hit, you're meeting that target because money is your primary driver. I need to hit that target. What you'll do is you'll take on clients that are not a fit because you're hitting that target. You do it unconsciously. And some people do it consciously, let's be honest, right? So then it becomes about hitting the target. And so then you start to like go, well, your gut and your intuition is telling you this isn't the right client, but then you take that client on anyway because there's a target to hit. That's a subtle difference between unconscious selling and conscious enrollment, which is what I call it, right? Hard closing versus conscious enrollment. And then you've got the marketing, which is unconscious marketing, manipulation, false scarcity, you know, manipulating numbers just to show you got a certain amount of people when half of those are just like bots or people, like it's a little BS just to present something. And that's what's happening. People are presenting themselves, but actually behind the scenes, the reality is that is not true. And when you live your life like that, and you're, you know, it happens even with New York Times bestsellers. It's like a manipulated system. And what we're experiencing now in the world is these systems, people are starting to feel and sense that they don't want to live that way anymore. And when that's happening, that's such a head FCK, right? It messes with you because your body's telling you that this thing doesn't feel right, but you've got to make the change. That's awakening. When you're willing to make the change against all the old paradigms and the systems to step into a new level of evolution that feels right and is actually to the universe's order.
Yeah. These days, like in my 20 years of marketing, all the skills and tactics I've learned, my marketing is how do I tone down all these skills that I've used in the past? And how do I not use most of them that no longer serves me? It's like using fear to sell is a big one. Keep priving on people's insecurity that you're not enough, like you need this, you need that. And yeah, today someone asked me to write a headline and like, what is this about? And I wrote a headline. They asked me, can you include some fear in there that people are moving away from? Which I thought is interesting. I didn't resist against it because part of it is about speaking the language that other people are speaking and I understand where it comes from, but it's just, it doesn't come as natural anymore.
Well, I think there's a difference between manipulation and also talking about what's real. Like pain is real. We need to talk about pain, you know? But when we're doing something that doesn't need to be done, that's where it's out of alignment. Like I think sometimes in marketing, you do need to talk about the reality. Because so many people are out of reality. And if we don't talk about the reality that we're living in and the actual pain that people are in, we're going to continue to create, to keep people in a reality and not allow them to step into their truest self. So it's not easy because some of those patterns and stuff still do creep in. But your body's always telling you, whatever's right for you or right for me, it's like your body's giving you a signal. This doesn't feel right. This feels a bit off. You know, I had some stuff today going on with some of my social media stuff. And I'm like, I need to sit down and think about whether I want to carry on doing some of this stuff because something doesn't feel right about this. And so I have to sit with that and spend time with that. And also, like you said earlier, like look at it from multiple perspectives, you know, because some might argue that some things are not wrong. And what if that headline was to change 10,000 people's lives in a positive way? You know? So it's not all simple, you know? So, yeah.
So I want to ask a question. When you were still building up your identity of as an entrepreneur and you're striving for the Ferrari, striving for the big mansion, and not only that, like you had a lot of good friends as well. You had people that loved and cared about you. So it's not just the material stuff. You had like good feeling stuff that came your way. And now if I was to say, looking back at your life now, I imagine you would say that, hey, it's definitely like, there's no regret moving away from the Ferrari and the big mansion or that lifestyle. And I'm cautious not to put a label to say this is better than that because that was a phase that you needed to go through. But I guess like where I'm getting at is when I was looking at the awakening entrepreneurial journey, one of the things for me that gave me assurance or gave me faith to take this leap is reading the book, The Surrender Experiment by Michael Singer. He's someone that's kind of gone off this spiritual path and meditate and did all this stuff, but yet he still had something that, at least a trait that I could resonate with back then as an entrepreneur, which is he built a $1 billion business. So if you're to convince your old self, not convince, but to shine a light to say that, you know what, even though it may not be Ferraris and mansion, but why is this life, again, trying to not to use the paradigm of better, but why is this life is the path that you should follow? Whether it's right now or whether it's in 20 years time, eventually feel assured. Don't be scared of this path. How would you describe that? Like where you're at right now is like, you know what, it's just it's almost in a way it's better, but I don't want to put that label on it. Does that make sense? Because it's almost like a grown-up is taller, is stronger, is better than a toddler. Yeah, we get it from one sense, it's better, but it's not diminishing that the toddler is, it may be wiping the diapers and struggling to walk, is inadequate. It's just that in the current life view that it's just perfect.
Yeah, I mean, that's everyone's, like you said earlier, everyone's on a different journey and a different path. Now, you said, you know, I needed to do those things. You know, I've invested a lot of money in myself. And so one of my missions is to say, well, for some people, they don't have that money to invest into to get a transformation. So I want to shortcut that process. So I actually believe that I can teach some people some things so that they don't need to get a Ferrari or do that to understand that they can be happier about themselves and come to their truest selves, right? For some people, they do need to go through that and they won't get it. And I didn't. When even when I saw people letting go of stuff, I still was, I don't want to do that. That's like,
exactly.
You know? So for me, but I truly believe for other people, they, because I have experienced people where they're like, oh my God, I just realized this thing from you and now I don't want that thing anymore. So everyone's different because they're brought up differently and they have different experiences. And so my goal is to shortcut people's path to their truest self.
So then what will you say to yourself like 20 years back?
What will I say to myself
if you need to travel back in time? And yeah,
that's a great question. Listen to your heart and let that guide you. If you still want those things, go for it. Because that was the big thing for me, just not listening to myself and actually not knowing what listening to myself is. What is listening to yourself? Like, how you got to understand you have different parts of you. You got to understand that you do have an ego. You got to understand you do have a calm place within you that can handle situations with grace versus flip out. And if you don't know that that part exists within you, then you're going to spend a life in confusion.
And what if the 20-year-old version of yourself said, how do I listen to myself? I don't get it.
Yeah. Right. I don't know. I'm a little confused on that one.
Yeah, maybe it's just perfect the way it is. If you don't know, you're not meant to know. Mm-hmm. Not yet. Because you say that people are on different paths. Maybe the 20-year-old self is not meant to find out if that moment is just stuck and the teacher feels there's no need to respond. There's no response that needs to be forthcoming. It's just not the right time. That's why they say when the student is ready, the teacher will appear.
Yep.
Thank you for sharing all your wisdom today. So if someone wants to learn more about Simon and all the great work that you do and the mentoring you do, where do they go?
Well, since you're on the podcast platform, head to Unshakable Leaders, which is available on iTunes, Spotify. I do a free meditation every Monday and also a couple of other episodes. And those episodes and those meditations are geared towards entrepreneurs, CEOs.
What is the Unshakable Leaders about?
It's emotional intelligence. For high performance, super high performance. And then also as I mentioned, every Monday, helping someone with a free meditation. I love recording different types of meditations specific to entrepreneurs. So that shows there. And also head to simonlovell.com where you can find out more about the different programs. Also, if you want to get a copy of the book, it's on Amazon, The Blackboard. Does anybody else have a secret? Is the name. If you want a free downloadable copy of that, you can head to simonlovell.com/blackball.
Love it. Thank you so much for your time. And I really look forward to seeing all the wonderful leaders that you help to awaken within them, their personality, their true spirit and their soul, all aligning together to create a more conscious economy and a more conscious world. Thank you, brother.
Thank you so much. Take it easy.